I'm not really a total foreigner to Qatar. I've been involved in research funded in Qatar since 5 years. Yesterday, Professor Dewul presented a project we've been running for the past 4 or 5 years on BIM. And after myself, there is as well another project I'm involved in as a principal investigator on BIM competencies. So I see there is a value in talking about BIM in Mexico for the Qatari audience. So I'll give two types of background for this presentation. The first background is background to the project itself, what, who was involved, what we have done in Qatar. This project, between the UK and Mexico, there is a program called Future Cities Program. This program basically is aimed at improving the living conditions in Mexico through improved mobility, infrastructure, and digitalization. It has basically, this specific project had two main outputs. One, at improving mobility through sustainable mobility plans, and the second one is about digital transformation. I was involved personally in the digital transformation, so in the second bullet points. Specific objective for the digital transformation, basically we were asked to assess where is Mexico in terms of BIM, so what's the to identify the BIM baseline in Mexico. The second thing, we they asked us as well to look at how BIM is adopted on major projects like Mexico City Airport, metro lines, stadiums, and to benchmark BIM adoption between Mexico and a number of international countries, and mainly with a greater focus on the UK. And finally, to provide a recommendation for a national BIM policy or a national BIM roadmap. The people who were involved in this project is myself and Dr. David Gibbs from a consultancy called HKA. HKA is the largest dispute and resolution company in the world with more than 1,000 employees. So we were involved in this project. We went to Mexico for about 3 weeks where we interviewed all major stakeholders, all major ministries. We ran about 40 hours of workshops. But more interestingly, really, to my close to my heart is not the consultancy itself, it's the research underpinning the consultancy. Because at the end, I'm an academic, I'm a researcher. So I will a little bit give you some background. How I got involved into the forum of consultants in the first place. In 2011, myself and Dr. Bilal Sukkar, who is sitting here in the first row, we identified back in 2011, we realized there are lots of countries around the world considering adopting BIM at countrywide level. However, there were lots of questions no one can answer, not only in academia, but also in industry. For example, what a national BIM policy, what a national BIM adoption policy, what should contain, how a country BIM maturity can be measured and benchmarked, how long it takes for a BIM mandate to take effect, and a long list of questions, all basically questions pertaining to adopting BIM at countrywide level. You know, if you're not familiar with BIM, basically it's a digitalization of the construction sector. So there were lots of questions not answered in academia, not answered in practice. There were lots of opinion. We said we need to bring rigor to this area. We need to bring definitive answers. Back in 2011, I teamed up with Dr. Bilal Sukkar, and we said, let's do something serious about this area. And we started actually back in 2010. We started doing research, doing publication in this area, until we basically, in the meantime, between 2011 and 2016, we have done a consultancy for the Brazilian government on the same topic. We have offered our model for use in about 8 countries. Currently, there are about 7-8 countries using those models currently, right now, live for assessing their national BIM maturity. And we basically became like very recognized internationally in this topic. So wherever there is a government or national consultancy, we get a call to get involved. So that's basically the background. The main outcome we did from this research over the last 5 years are, you can see those are tools to help answering those questions. One of the main tools is really the second one which I used in this consultancy, which I'll talk about in detail, just the second one with the eight corners there. So now what we have done basically in Mexico are a few stages. Basically those are traditional steps of a commercial consultancy: assess and analyze basically what's the current situation now. And to do that, we run lots of workshops. We use that model, which I'll explain in details in the remainder, in the second part of this presentation. We reviewed projects, we reviewed standards in Mexico and internationally. We benchmarked Mexico against the United Kingdom, against Chile, against Germany, against Finland, and a number of other countries. Then we developed a recommendation, and we went through our recommendations to lots of expert interview in the UK and back in Mexico, and at the end we finalized a set of recommendations which we presented to the Mexican government. I would have liked to cover all of those in my presentation today, but there isn't time, and there is a certain degree of embargo. I was told yesterday by email, you can't present everything. So I'm presenting mainly stage one and stage two. Basically it's the diagnosis about what's the baseline of women in Mexico. Lots of lessons we can learn from Mexico are relevant to Qatar. I have been involved in Qatar since about 5 years. I can tell you lots of lessons we learned are relevant to Qatar. So I'll go now, in the remainder part of the presentation, I'll explain this tool, call it tool, it's not a tool, it's a model, but just for simplicity, where we explained one by one and what we found in Mexico with regard to its component. Before that, this model can be used for a number of purposes. One is to assess a country. Two, to benchmark a country against a number of selected countries. And three, very importantly, you can actually use it qualitatively to analyze an existing policy and improve it. And that's the use we adopted in Mexico. So I'll start this model and explain those components as I apply them to Mexico. So the first component, we call it objective stages and milestones. This component basically refers to a country looking seriously to them. Most countries, they have strategies. As part of those strategies, they have market-wide BIM objective, stages and milestones. Are really important for the market to give like a direction for the whole market. And in Mexico, basically, when we analyzed with five ministries and with lots of workshops, it was clear there was no countrywide BIM objective, stages or milestones. However, for example, relevant to this component is the value proposition. How the public sector perceives digitalization of construction. We realized in Mexico, every ministry we talk to, they have the same value proposition. They want transparency of information, accuracy, they want to reduce cost and time of projects. This is the same value proposition across all ministries. There was actually, although there wasn't a countrywide BIM objective, there was a draft of a national map in one of the ministries. When we analyzed that national roadmap, for example, one of the definitions they have adopted is not inclusive. You should, when you are developing a national BIM strategy, the definition is really important. You need to make a definition that's inclusive, that's time, that lasts over time, not very specific. So there was a definition that's not really time-proof, so we gave some recommendation about how to improve that. There was no concern at all about the capital, the operational phase of projects. No one cares about it. We talked to all ministries, they all want to sort out the design and construction phases. They want to tackle those phases. Very importantly, they have something called Public Act Law, Public Work Act, that governs all public performance, and it's difficult to mandate things through the Public Act. So it's unlikely that we can have a national bill mandate in Qatar under the Public Work Act. Why? Because the Public Work Act needs to be addressed at federal level, so you need to change the law at federal level, and it's a very, very lengthy process. However, you will see later on in my presentation, we found a way of making BIM mandatory in Mexico using basically another way when I talk about another component related to the regulatory framework. So moving on to the second component. Second component is changes and drivers. Basically, if you have a country where BIM is being promoted at countrywide level, you will have to have a driver, someone with a mandate from a policymaker to look after the adoption of BIM, to encourage the adoption of BIM and coordinate its adoption. Champions are basically volunteers, could be individual, could be group, but they don't have a mandate from policymakers. So what we found in Mexico, we found there is a very limited number of champions promoting BIM adoption within the private sector. There was something like Chamber of Commerce, of Construction and Commerce. In the public sector, they were, in every ministry we went to, they were really some enthusiasts and people who are really keen to get the digital transformation. And they were all willing to work together. However, what they were like, it was clear, lots of enthusiasts across all ministries, but they all waited for direction. All of them. They want someone to take the lead. There was, for example, it's interesting, they all looked at other countries in Latin America, so they wanted to coordinate with Chile, with neighboring country Brazil, to have like a task force that they can coordinate the adoption. Interestingly, across all ministries, we found there is a generation gap that basically hindering the work of these champions and drivers, because like lots of people were aged, I'm not saying they are old, aged 55 and over, but you know there was like a clear divide between the younger generation and the old generation. The mainly BIM was driven by the young generation. And the staff turnover, really, like lots of people suffering from, like there is a group of young people who wants to drive BIM in one of the ministry, suddenly their management had changed from someone who was really interested in promoting BIM to someone, a new management who really is not interested at all. So they were suffering a lot from this staff turnover at the management level. Moving on to the next component, regulatory framework. This is very interesting. Without this, really, you can't go far in adopting BIM. We know BIM, you need a way of embedding BIM within construction contracts. You need to look at a solution within your regulatory framework. In Mexico, mainly, obviously, you need to look at what type of procurement and contract it's adopted in your country. In Mexico, mainly they adopt the design, build, and build, similarly to Qatar yesterday in Nash's presentation, that came as the most used procurement method in Qatar. There was some private-public partnership as well used. And as I said, all project has to comply with the Public Work Act, and that's very difficult to amend. So what we did here, we sat with lawyers. They ran for us a lecture on regulatory framework in Mexico, and we identified a way of mandating BIM. It's not a blanket mandate on all projects, but basically what we do, there is a level of standardization called, they have three layers of standardization. One is executive standards, those are mandatory, but they have a layer under the executive standard, it's not mandatory, it's called Mexican norms, that's actually a reference norm. Basically, if you reference that norm within the procurement, within the tender documents, then it becomes mandatory. Yeah, so that's the only way we could advise about making BIM mandatory without requiring any change at federal and Congress level. So that was very, very interesting way of looking at including BIM in public procurement. Moving on to the next component. What was the complication? This basically refers to all standard, all documents, all like noteworthy publication at market-wide level. So in Mexico, similarly, I think to Qatar, there was limited big documentation and standards available at market-wide level and recognized by the industry. They were very open to use international standard as long as they can be tailored to their needs. What they were using really fragments of international standards. They take a concept from the US, like the level of details. They take some concept from another country, like document management. So there was no like whole standard taken from elsewhere to Mexico. So they were like, kind of ad hoc for projects. On project-by-project basis. Some ministries, they have internal standards specific for their activity, like the Ministry of Health. Learning and education, in this document we refer to basically what opportunities in private and in higher education and in vocational training is available within the market and how affordable it is. What we realized here is there is a clear divide between public and private universities. Like curriculum change quickly within private university, but it's much slower in public universities. The market is starting to look for professionals with good competencies. Industry training is available, but mainly software-led, and there was an issue with trainers, mostly our technologists. They are not experienced in construction. Most training is modeling for visualization. And they have just started their like big BIM conferences at national level, BIM congresses. They launched like the first BIM congress in Mexico. Again, here there was a huge generation issue, even in the universities. So before rolling out BIM for students, they have to train all staff. Next component is measurement and benchmark. This component refers to like how you assess project teams, how you assess organization, how you assess individual, how you assess that they have the capabilities or maturity or competencies they claim to have. And we realize this is actually a problem that's growing in Mexico. Lots of ministries say my supply chain is claiming certain BIM capabilities, but I don't have any way of assessing them, any way of measuring their assessing or verifying their claims. And this is actually the project that Jamal will be talking after this one, because this is actually the research project we currently have in Qatar. We are addressing basically this first issue. Tenders in Mexico, similarly, I think in Qatar, I have seen tenders in Qatar are the same thing. What they are doing, they're just extending pre-BIM qualification criteria and making them BIM specific. Basic criteria, years of experience, qualification, accreditation. And it's, in Mexico, this way, this kind of pre-qualification is not working well because once they bring people, technologists with them, but they have poor industry experience. And the government clearly said in Mexico, we need to look after this area. We can't just leave it for, like it happened in the UK, this area was overlooked and lots of things happened without any coordination. Lots of people offering accreditation, certification. We advised the Mexican government, this is a sensitive area, an important area, keep control over it. The penultimate component, standardized parts and deliverable. This refers to anything that's really standardized. Could be a template for developing protocols, could be a BIM object library, could be a standard list of model users. In Mexico, there was little of that, very, very little. There was like no standard BIM template, very little object libraries, classification systems they use. They use an American classification systems. Some ministries, like the Ministry of Health, for example, they had their internal asset libraries, but they were not developed according to any standards, they were ad hoc, they were not maintained very well. And they were obviously very interested in having digital BIM libraries and that are software agnostic, as they don't want to be, or file format agnostic rather than software agnostic. Finally, technology infrastructure. This is actually the component that raised the most debate in Mexico. This one referred to network, hardware, and software. We measure their affordability, their availability. And what we found in Mexico is there is all sort of challenges. There is internet restriction. Basically, even in ministries, they have issues with large files. There is lots of bespoke software for document sharing. They use like, not for example, common data environment, professional common data environment, they use just extranet. External workers, because of security, government network security, they have difficulty of accessing the government intranet or the government network. Software and hardware are seen really as cost centers, very expensive, they're seen as expensive as, rather than investments. And very importantly, a huge limitation is the way they procure software for ministries. It's a long process that goes from federal level down to individual ministry. It goes through like planning, submission of a proposal, approval. It's very, very, it's not a process that's fit for digital transformation. It has to be revised. So based on this assessment, this is the last slide, by the way. Based on this assessment, what we did, we have scores about those eight components from across about 20 plus countries. We collected some researchers with our Sudkar. And what we did, we did a gap analysis. We identified the gap Mexico has compared to the rest of the world. We interviewed top experts in the UK working on measured projects like Crossrail, HS2. Those who led the digital transformation in the UK over the last 5 years. We did all of those interviews. We discussed the recommendation we are trying to do for Mexico, and we put all recommendations in a, like, we didn't put directly in the roadmap, but we told them how they can, we gave them a template, which is this one. It's basically, those are the eight areas I explained in the first column, and on the top line is a timeline. Basically, you just put your objective against each component, against time, and you will have, believe it or not, you can get one of the best roadmap currently. If you check our methodology against what's available in terms of roadmap on the market currently published by different countries, you'll get a better roadmap by following this method. Thank you very much.